one thing about Scottish crannogs and wetland settlement in general is that it can be wonderfully frustrating, because you have all this beautiful organic preservation, but very often it just fails to be integrated into the mainstream archaeological narrative. Now, what I'd like to talk about today is some of the things we are doing at CERC to address this problem of integration, and from the angle of, as you might possibly guess, chronology. Now, when it comes to any kind of a chronology-based project, there are three things to worry about: technique, practice, and meaning. Technique is, do we actually have the methods and the capability to get the results we need to answer our questions? Practice is that's the bit in between. That's whether we actually can get the samples out there in the field, what are the catches, what is the nature of our archaeological sites. And the meaning is the big question of, why do we bother with dating? What kind of information we hope to get out from it? Where are we going with it? So today I'll begin with speaking about a bit about the meaning. Why do we want to have those chronologies a bit better than they are? And then move into the technique, practice, and go back to a couple of case studies that are either finished or ongoing. So, Scottish wetland sites. When it comes to organic preservation, they're beautiful. You have cut marks, if need be. You have perfect preservation of environmental remains. You also have organic artifacts, such as the art from underneath cut slot, which is the second art found under a crannog. And then you have whole major structural elements in timber still surviving all the way back to the beginning of the Iron Age. However, to know all these things, we need to excavate these sites, and we need to excavate them sometimes through the water table, sometimes underwater. If we look at them in survey, well, if we're lucky, we get a sad stony island somewhere. Sometimes it gets a bit more mysterious. Spot the crannog. Survey here. That one will actually be getting a couple of test trenches through it this summer. Michael Strategos from Aberdeen is telling me. And of course, then we have some of them underwater. Right here in the middle, you can see very clearly Oak Bank crannog. Now, that is a very different kind of an archaeological resource from what's happening on the ground, where you can say, oh, there are some things, there are cut circles and ramparts, and you can say that already from the air without needing to break the ground. Yes, to get something more, you might need to dig, but you can already say something at this level. And then you might also be working in the Atlantic world, where you have still upstanding stone structures. At the same time, you don't get the organic preservation. So what is happening is there is this rift in the nature of the archaeological remains themselves. You have the wetlands, which in very economic, speaking economically, you need to put more into them in order to get your returns, but once you start getting your returns, they go for longer. And then you have the terrestrial archaeology, where you can start getting things much sooner, but you run out of new information from the site also sooner. And in an ideal world, we would have linkage between them. Now, by linkage here I mean very specifically, you excavate a wetland site, you're gaining knowledge there, means that there is a gain in knowledge about things happening in the period to which it belongs in general. And that is not so much of a problem throughout wetland archaeology in Europe, because linkage works through three pillars: space, time, and material culture. Sites like Biskupin in Poland, they are taken into the mainstream archaeological narrative with absolute ease, because there is diagnostic material culture that brings them into oh, we're speaking about the Lusitz culture. Well, Biskupin is a Lusitz culture site. There is linkage there. Most crannogs in Scotland come from the Iron Age, and Scottish Iron Age has very little diagnostic material culture. We need to develop our concepts of linkage based on space and time alone. Now, I will not go into space, it's not my job. I'll focus solely on time. The catch with time is we need to be able to get the features we want. I mean, to be able to get the dates we need for them. This might not always be doable through dendrochronology, because a lot of those features are built in, a lot of those crannogs are built in older. You cannot get absolute dendrochronological dates for all the timbers, and therefore we have to default to radiocarbon. Now, radiocarbon 101. A radiocarbon age determination in radiocarbon USBP is only a very fancy unit of saying how much radiocarbon there is in a sample. In order for this to be meaningful for chronology, we need to calibrate this radiocarbon age determination. So we run it through a calibration curve and we get a calibrated date range. And the way we read this is this sample would have died sometime between this point and this point. And that is very important for whether we're able to interpret and link these sites within their surroundings. An example. At Oakbank Crannog, opium poppy was discovered. Now, we know that this opium poppy was imported. We might also want to know whether people at the nearby Fernan Crannog knew something about this shameful precedent going on or not. In order to answer that, we need to see whether the two sites are aligned in time. And we have some radiocarbon dates from Oakbank, and we also have a radiocarbon date from Fernan. The radiocarbon date from Oakbank generally tells us that Oakbank happened sometime between 750 BC and 400 BC. The radiocarbon dates from Fernan tell us exactly the same. So how do we interpret it? Are they two contemporaneous? Well, the answer is, we don't know. This range could have been somewhere here. It could have been around 700 BC. And the Oakbank could have been happening around 450 BC. So, the two could have been 250 years apart, but also they could have been built at the same time. Because of the broad calibration ranges, we cannot answer our question here. And this is because of the shape of the calibration curve. There is a nasty period in the mid-first millennium BC when the calibration curve is almost flat, and that means that your calibrated date ranges, even if they're modern precise measurements, will come back very broad. So to answer our archaeological questions on linking wetland settlement to sites around, we need a way out. Tree rings give us this way out. Now, we cannot dendrodate every single timber on a wetland site in Scotland. But there is a bypass that combines dendrochronology and radiocarbon. Each tree ring will have a radiocarbon signature of the year in which it was formed. So if we take measurements through these tree rings, we can match them to the calibration curve. And as you can see, the calibration curve goes up and down and up and down, and all those little turns, they are very professionally termed wiggles. Hence, wiggle matching. You match your little section of the curve from your tree rings to the master calibration curve. And yes, when you make your measurements, they still might seem quite broad, but after you match them, you can get down to precision that is fairly ridiculous. Of course, it's never so simple. This particular wiggle match is an experiment that was conducted in something like 2009 or 10. And it uses the kind of measurements that are very difficult to obtain. They're very precise. And this means that it's not economically viable to build wiggle matches this way. And here is where this whole project took off. How to make it's economically viable, so Historic Scotland doesn't go bankrupt on it. And the other thing is, what kind of samples do we want from those timbers? Do we want decadal blocks or do we want single rings? To answer that, we took a non-aged timber and dated 50 consecutive rings, so we know which year each ring grew in. We wanted to see the radiocarbon content. And that's what happened. And you can see it goes up and down and up and down around the calibration curve. This means that the calibration curve does not have the resolution to go with single ring data. So what we're using instead, and what I would recommend for anyone who wants to do eagle matching in prehistory or effectively before AD 1500, is use decadal blocks of wood. Then the next thing is sampling. The problem with the Oak Bank eagle match, which was the previous one, the very nice one, is that it was only one date and one timber. Now, as we'll see in a few slides, one timber really doesn't tell us anything. We need more. The way around is, paradoxically, to sacrifice the precision of your wiggle matches as they are. Don't put in all your funds into a single timber. Spread it across a number of timbers and get quite close results. But if you know that the timbers are in a structural association with each other, so you found them as a floor or as a retaining palisade, you can then use some Bayesian statistics to combine them. And that, in turn, brings you back down to a window of about 100 years. And with windows like that, you can start working. And note, this is a window of about 100 years on that worst part of the calibration curve. Outside that worst part, after 400 BC, you shouldn't really be happy with anything that's more than 50 years. So, that's technique. Let's see how it works out in practice. And to do that, we looked at structure one at Black Rock of Merton. Black Rock of Merton is a marsh settlement in southwest Scotland, in Galloway. And it has this very beautiful half structure straight in the middle. Now, within this half structure, you've got a couple refurbishment phases, and you have those large timbers retaining it. And the large timbers are beautiful. They're beautiful radiocarbon dating material. Oh, okay. So, what we did was we took a couple of timbers, first two smaller ones, and we did quite coarse wiggle matches on them, and here you can see that actually it's still quite broad, but we can already say it's either around 700 BC or either around 500 BC. We then got some good news from Anne Crone. She managed to do some dendrochronology on them. We don't have absolute dates for those two timbers, but we know they were felled in the same year. So we can factor in this information, and now we're down to either the very onset of the Iron Age or this period around 500 BC. Moving on, we have two large timbers, and here something interesting happens, because they produced different dates. How do we interpret it? Well, I'm going in with the interpretation that if you look here, this three agree. This one stands further back in time. What happening is, and we know that these have been built, put into the structure together at one point in time. So, I do believe that what we have evidence for here is reuse of timber in the Iron Age. And that's the reason why we cannot go with dating a single timber per feature. We need feature-oriented sampling that tries to understand the dating structure of the features within the features, and from that, from getting good dates on features, start rebuilding the site. So, how is it going on with these results further on? Well, we take all of the wiggle match results, we add in the results from the consecutive half deposits, and from that we can get a construction date for the site, which is sitting somewhere between 510 BC and around 440 BC. And I like this result because as we are working on it, Alan managed to dendrodate a couple of oak plaques from elsewhere within the structure. And that is her felling range. So we do actually have a congruence between the wiggle matches and the tentative dendrochronological determinations for Blackwood. So, where do we go beyond that, and what do we move in when it comes to meaning? Well, our poster child for this is the Karlslag project. There are four sites of Karlslag. 1, 3, 4, and 5. Don't ask about 2, it was a mistake. Karlslag 1 will also not be discussed here because it hasn't been excavated and there is only one date that I'm not sure whether I believe. Of the remaining sites, Karlslag 3 is a crannog. Karlslag 4 is a promontory fort. And Karlslag 5, over here, is a palisaded enclosure. And over the course of the past 5 years or so, the amount of wiggle matches and radiocarbon dates from the two terrestrial sites allowed us to get a picture of what's happening in terms of chronology around Karlslag. And we can see that the whole thing kicks off in just around the beginning of the Iron Age at Karlslag 5, and then the activity at Karlslag 5 stops. Next, the promontory fort and the crannog appear to begin at roughly the same time. And they appear to end at roughly the same time. They begin around 500 BC, they end round around sometime after 400 BC up to maybe 300 BC. Then there is most probably a gap and a resumed activity at Karlslag 5. Now, one thing that I'm thinking of when I'm looking at those dates and this photograph. These two sites, which are chronologically identical, don't lie so far apart. Should we actually be speaking here about two different sites, a crannog and a promontory fort, or should we be speaking here about a single site with a terrestrial and a wetland component? Now, the other thing that's going on, and that is to match the title of the conference, because this is research in progress, no results yet, is the crannogs in the Clyde, in the Firth of Clyde. There are altogether 4 surviving sites, but we could only get timbers from 2 of them, Dunbuck and Erskine Crannog. And what we're hoping to do here is we're hoping to get the chronological relationship between them, because there have been some radiocarbon dates done in the 90s, and they cover a lot of very interesting times. Roman invasion. There, I think, based on other radiocarbon modeling of sites from the southwest, there might also be a settlement turnover happening earlier, before just around the turn of the millennium. There might be something happening around 200 BC. With those dates as they are, we cannot say whether these crannogs are related to any of these events or whether they are somewhere else in time. So what we're hoping to do is to narrow these ranges down and see what's happening. And I'm also hoping that at some point in time it might be possible to extend this to include the hill fort on Ship's Hill over here. And also, what has been very fortunate, there is a bunch of radiocarbon dates from a palisaded enclosure at Mar Hall. Unfortunately, those dates, once you model them, they all fall somewhere before the crannog, so I can't give you the nice kind of two-component site anymore, sorry. So, to conclude, where did we get to? On a technical level, I think that it's safe to say that when it comes to wetland settlement in Scotland, we can achieve precision of about 100 years in calibrated years, on the worst parts of the calibration curve. On the better parts, hopefully this should be sitting somewhere around 50 years. In terms of practice, I do believe that it's absolutely paramount that we think in terms of features rather than timbers or samples from across the site. because there is a risk of reuse. If a black block, I only had that one reuse timber from that feature and a couple of younger timbers from other features, the interpretation would probably change. And in terms of meaning, I do believe that for the time being, the best and the most robust way to employ high-precision dating in wetland archaeology in Scotland is this pursuit of linkage and linking different kinds of sites together into a single narrative. Thank you for listening, and I would like to thank the Caledonian Research Fund for keeping me alive, Historic Scotland for giving me the money for doing the measurements, and AOC Archaeology for providing the samples. Thank you.